is on.
Restart, yeah.
Attention, okay. Please, want to start the budget work session, April 27, 2015. I'm Randy Guy, County Commissioner President. And of course, we have Mr. Hewitt, Commissioner, Mr. Jarbo, Mr. O'Connor, and I think Mr. Morgan wants to say a little thing.
Thank you. thank you, Mr. President. I'd like to start just by commenting on the very unsettling tone in the community regarding the location of the library. It has me very concerned since I've sat up here for a while, in a couple of years, and, you know, having friend against friend and neighbor against neighbor is never a good method of public policy. And having piles of mail come in like this that says, is what I want, is not, in my mind, sound public policy. The citizens elected us to perform policy and make decisions that sometimes are good and sometimes are bad. But the three-ring circus that's sort of entailed out of, you know, where we are today has me deeply concerned. And I would sort of just request out there, maybe I'll see what the board says. You know, we're supposed to come up with this decision on May 12th of the location. And sometimes when you have labor management negotiations, a cooling off period has to take place. And I realize that next Tuesday we're going to have a public forum and we're going to have more spokespersons coming forward to say Leonardtown, Hayden Farm, whatever. But for the purpose of public policy and where we stand today, my concern is just to slow this down a little bit. The commissioners, I think, have a lot of information made available to them. Secretary Craig, obviously, is coming down tomorrow. He'll have something, obviously, for an input. But I just think a cooling off period needs to take place, and the amount of rhetoric and finger pointing and things like that are out there. I just don't think that's good for the community. I don't think it's good for public policy. And as commissioners, you've entrusted us to make sound decisions. And that's sort of where I sit today, sir.
I'd just like to add, if I could, to that, that, you know, in the end of the day, getting a new library is a very positive impact for the community. So I hope we don't lose fact or lose sight of the fact that St. Mary's County is going to get a new library. That's what we're pushing forward for. So I agree with Commissioner Morgan. Thank you for your comments. Everyone's going to be a winner, regardless of the site. They just are. And we're going to do our best use of our resources and taxpayer money to make a sound decision that gets the best bang for the buck. And that's what we're hired to do, and that's what we're going to do. Thank you.
Any other comments before we get started?
I think it's important that people are heard. What we've been hearing a lot is, Mayor, tell us there's a silent majority out there. I don't agree that a silent majority is going to carry the day. We need to hear from people. So I'm not afraid to hear from people. I'm not afraid for people to make their point. The key is you need to leave no stone unturned on a decision like this, because I'm a firm believer in making decisions, because I'm a firm believer that if you make the wrong decision, you can change your mind and correct it. That's not the case here. Once this library goes in, wherever it goes, it's going to be there for 30, 40 or more years. So it needs to be done right. And this is people's opportunity to come out and tell us what they want. So I'm fine with it. Do I think it's acrimonious? Not really. I think people have their, where they want to be, they have their pet peeve or their pet place. That's okay. But again, Commissioner Morgan's right. We need to make a sound decision based upon what's best for the entire county. And hey, I'm good with getting all these emails. At least we're hearing from people, and that's positive.
I'm glad to hear from people as well, but to echo what Commissioner Morgan said, and I think I voiced this 2 weeks ago, very disappointed in the divide that it's caused in the community, and or the rift, however you want to word it. A library is supposed to join people together. It's positive. This is something for the entire community, like Commissioner Jarbo said. So I just hope that there is a cooling off period and everybody realizes that we're, regardless of where it goes, it's a positive thing that's going to help the entire county.
And I feel the same way, and that's why I set the agenda for May 12th to make a decision. I don't want to waste any more time with this. And I think most of us have seen enough. We're getting enough input right now. and I want it to move forward. That's doing business. That's what I plan to do. Now, with that said, we're going to move on now with our hearing here for the budget work session, and I'm going to turn it over to Ms. Cudmore.
Thank you very much. We have an agenda here. Now, this is usually after the work session that we do, that we debrief. You know, we come back after the public hearing. You know, you received comments on the 14th. We got out of there at a good time. I think it was about almost 9:30. That was a great thing. And then you were able to receive comments until April 24th, last Friday. So in this package, I'm not going to go through all of these comments.
Please read them all to us.
No.
We were there.
We heard them all. We heard them all.
It's like 244 pages. Okay.
All day.
And this was as of about noon on Friday. And then, it's on Board Docs. If anybody would like to print them off, you can go to Board Docs and print them off and view them there. This morning, the remaining came in, and that will also go on Board Docs. Okay? So that's the first part of the agenda, where it says public hearing sign-up speakers and public hearing comments. The next area, I kind of broke it into three sections. First, we're going to go over the general fund, and we're going to look at the revenue and expense summary, where we are now. We're going to look at the changes worksheet that represents what's happened since the recommended budget. Then we're going to look at appeals and alignments. And the changes worksheet and the appeals and the realignments they're going to go together. I kind of dovetailed where the pages are and how we went through that. I probably should have put it like in an extra book where you can have one here and one here, but I didn't get to it. But that's okay. We can do this. And then after we finish the general fund, then we're going to go to the enterprise fund changes. And I did those a little bit differently this year, too. In the past, we kind of had the same kind of a changes spreadsheet that we used to have for the general fund. And sometimes it got confusing because we were thinking that the changes were almost the same changes, but they were really different funds, and we really want to keep them separate. So I kind of took the sheet that was in the recommended budget that you're used to seeing, those enterprise sheets, and I made the adjustments and attached the different changes behind each of those sheets related to those funds. And then the last item we're going to talk about is the fund balance. I said in the recommended budget book that we were going to come back with a plan. So this is a kind of an estimated plan based on what we know now, and then also to make sure we have enough funding in case revenues come in short or anything happens next year like a hurricane or another big snowstorm. So that we all are safe and, we have funds to cover those and not have a structural deficit or anything like I think other counties are experiencing at this time. So right now we're going to flip the page, and we're going to go to the section that starts off with the general fund. And it's on page 1 and 2. And if you're looking at it and comparing it to your recommended budget book, in the recommended budget book, it's the updated page 8 and the updated page 15. And if you remember the recommended, we ended up with $221,114,974, both the revenues and the expenses balanced. And that is really our beginning place right now. So we're going to start with the recommended budget. So if you look on page 1, you can see our revenues are now $221,613,079. They actually increased by $387,000, the amount for the Board of Ed excludable cost. Because when we brought that to you on the 24th, we didn't have really a chance to put that into the fund balance because that's a non-recurring item. We should use fund balance for that. So that's really the increase in your revenues at this point. Plus, we also had some increases from the legislation, the legislative session that ended. They gave us, some estimates. And I'll go right now to page 3. And this is kind of a summary of the changes for revenues. So at the top, you can see there's the recommended budget going across the page. You can see the total revenue is the $221,114,974, which is in your recommended budget. and then we can work our way down. General fund revenues changed. There's actually a reduction of $500 for a grant that was not going to come in. And there's an offsetting a reduction in expense for that. The next item is an increase in revenue, an HR Medicare drug subsidy. That's $120,000. Actually, that should have been in the recommended. When we were going through and working on the book, we discovered that that wasn't actually included. So that's revenue that we're able to increase that should have already been in there. The next item is the $387,500. That's the excludable cost for the Board of Ed on what we submitted. And we actually, there's a letter in here from the state that they've already tentatively accepted it. Okay, so we're using fund balance for that. Social services, revenue to match. Because we, and I'll get to that when I get to the expenses, there's like parity. Because they actually have some county employees. They're on their side in social services, but they're on our payroll. So because our payroll is changing, like for health insurance and benefits and the merit increase, their payroll changes too. We didn't do anything with that in the recommended because we flat funded them, but I wanted to get that taken care of now and corrected and explain it to you. So you can see under charges for services, there's an increase of $1,691, and then there's a grant employee, there's an increase of $4,322, and that is for social services. The next line is for the highway user. We received that estimate from the state a couple times a year, and then they also give us an estimate in the legislative session. That's an increase of $11,919. And the next item is state aid for state police. That actually had a reduction of $43,937 compared to what we had in the recommended. Then we have parkland shared revenue. That was actually a revenue that was restored in 2015. We didn't have that budgeted in 2015. We were pleasantly surprised, I guess probably about October, when that revenue came in. I think it was like $116,000. But we used to get that years ago, and they kind of stopped. That was one of those things that they stopped. You know how the state made cuts, like in 2010. They actually restored it. And we had put $100,000 into the recommended, and the legislative report said it was $114,000. So we'll take that increase. The alcohol beverage revenue, there's an increase of $2,293. This is a revenue, one of the sheriff's revenues, and there's an offsetting expense increase in the alcohol beverage fund, so in their actual state agency. So that's, again, another one of the matching things, just like the social services. So now our revenues at this time, and on 4/27 today, is $221,613.079. So that is reflected on page one as your new draft revenues. Okay? And you can see on the bottom of that, I have like a little summary. We haven't gone through the expenses, but I'll go ahead and give you a little highlight here. As of today, the general fund on the expenses have increased. Are now, oh, I guess that's actually decreased. Now they're $220,122,460. So the difference today between the revenues and the expenses, we actually have an increase of $1.4 million that's available to make changes to and allocate. And that's primarily from the fund balance that we increased to $387,500, the pension rate, which I will get to shortly, correction, another correction of $277,227, and the public hearing reserve. Remember, we reversed that public hearing reserve because that was in the recommended. That was $682,373, right. And that's $1.3 million. So that's primarily the bulk of that $1.4 million that's available for you to allocate. Okay? So we're going to turn now. Do you all have any questions on revenues? Okay.
Well, I have one quick one. On the $120,000 for the HR medical drug subsidy,
yes.
Is that a reoccurring?
Yes, it has.
Good. Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
So let's turn the page to expenditure summary. Just like what you saw in the recommended budget book, this is the new updated page 15 in your recommended. And this is actually now equaling the $220,122,000. And if you look at the bottom of this page, you'll see that there's some more zeros. If you look at your page 15, that included the $682,373. That amount is now zero in your summary. Mm-hmm. Okay? And also, on the page 15 in the recommended budget book, there was $1,024,000. That was for the merit increase that needed to be allocated to all the departments and the elected officials, plus the compensation classification study that was not allocated. In April, we came back and we updated our payroll numbers and we allocated it. So now you can see that the total departments, they've increased a little bit, okay? And then the elected officials have increased. And like I already said earlier about alcohol, beverage, and social services, they've increased too because, you know, they do have employees that are in their agencies that are on our payroll. Okay. So in the recommended, I have just a note here. The departments actually, in the recommended, they had a 4.7% decrease. Now you can see on page two, it's only a 4.1% decrease compared to 2015 approved. And the total elected officials in the recommended book, they had a 1.1% increase at that time, and now they have an increase of 2.1 because I reallocated that $1,024,000. Let's see, that's good on that page. So let's now go to page four. That's the summary expenses. Again, the difference between the summary expenses and the summary revenues is that $1.4 million. The top of page four, just like on the revenue sheet, I had the recommended budget go across. I had the same thing happening on this sheet for expenses. So you can see there's the departments at 48.3, which was on page 15, the 41 million for elected officials, and in the transfer and reserves. That was 7 million in the recommended, and now that has now been reduced to remove the public hearing reserve and the classification study and merit. So that's now why that has actually dropped by the $1,024,000. So if you go to the first line under that recommended budget, you can see it's the classification study, the merit increase one step. That was approved in the recommended, but it has now been allocated to the departments and the elected officials. And it shows the breakdown. So realistically, our estimate, we were only off by $12,333. I was real excited about that. Because those were not really, they were estimates, but they weren't actually ran through our financial system upstairs. So you can see with that, it increased boards and state agencies by $16,102. And that again, like I said earlier, that is the alcohol, beverage, social services. Increased the elected officials by $478,253 and county departments by $541,978. Now, when we were running through and reallocating that $1,024,000, mm-hmm. we discovered an error in the payroll calculation, which was in our favor, thank goodness. We got the pension rates back in December, and we thought we had updated with the new rate of 8.53%. When we were looking at it, we kind of tested a few employees just to make sure things looked okay, and then we noticed, well, wait a minute, you know, we're not coming up with a new rate, we're still coming up with the old rate. So we looked at our setup, and there it was. The old rate was still in there. So, of course, we re-ran everything with the new rate, and now we have a savings of $277,227, which should have already been in the recommended. But I'm glad that the budget analysts upstairs, thank you, they discovered it. Okay? Turnover. What we do is we actually copy the live payroll in October, November, and into the budget module, we have a payroll budget module upstairs. And from the time we copy it over until, like, we do that in March, and then we do it actually this time, getting ready for the approved budget, we kind of review it and make sure, you know, we keep track of all the hires and the terminations and changes in health insurance if we can pick it up. And we usually get a turnover savings. Because our health insurance, because especially now with the 11% increase, actually for individual taking full family health, it's like $20,000. So you could have a few changes and you could have some turnover changes. So this turnover changes is actually taking place in county departments, and that's a savings of $47,000 on the next line. Okay? The next item is removing the public hearing reserve, the 682,373. That now becomes available for you to reallocate based on what you heard at the public hearing and also the public comment. The next line is, which was actually on the revenue, the matching. This is the matching expense. This is the increase for the alcohol beverage deputy. The revenue is in the sheriff's office. The expense is in the alcohol beverage. And then there's that $500 reduction, just like what we had, a $500 reduction in the revenue. So those changes actually shows a reduction to expenses of $992,514, bringing the expenses right now down to $222,460. Any questions with these changes?
No.
All right.
Any questions, guys?
No. All right. So now below on the next few pages, continuing on page 4 and page 5, we have we sent out something to the departments and the elected officials, and it was an opportunity for them to realign or request additional funds, which will be approved by you to start using up some of the savings that we've already identified. The first one, and actually I have them in order. If you go to page 6, that is actually the letter that we received back from MSDE. Okay. Under there, and there's two items first. It's compensation for multiple departments and elected officials. In this realignment is a general fund increase for hourly employees. There are a different set of employees that are separate from our regular merit employees. Which you said in the recommended to give them a 2.5% increase. So this is actually for the hourly employees, the non-benefited employees. And this increase will be $18,792. And as we go through these changes, if you'd like to give me direction at that time or if you'd like to wait until the end, I mean, it's your preference. Just let me know if you have any questions or comments. So that's the first item, requesting $18,792, 1%. And again, this is just for general fund. Remember, we're going to do enterprise later, and they have their increases too. Okay? The next item, and that is also on page 7 in your package. The consultant who did our classification study, there were a number of appeals that were resubmitted. I think there were like maybe 51. They came back and approved and recommended 4 positions to be increased or changed, reclassified. And the cost is $16,546, $11,000 for county departments and $5,000 for the sheriff's office.
Anybody got any questions on any of these while we're going?
Any questions or?
You want to do them as they go?
I mean, do you want to go?
I just assume do them all at the end.
Okay,
that's fine. That's fine. Yeah. I'll just keep on talking. Mm-hmm. All right. The next item, so that's related to compensation, those two items. The next items are actually appeals that came from the departments. The first one is for the county attorney. They're actually wanting to realign, and if you look on page 8 and 9, they're actually wanting to increase $10,000 to a new software, which will help them take care of monitor the boards and commissions. And they're wanting to reduce contract legal services by the same 10. So it's not an increase to their budget. It's actually a realignment to what was already in the recommended. The next item is for the Economic Development Department. With the relocation of the Agricultural and Seafood Division down to the new building down the road with the other agricultural type entities, they actually got a new printer. Well, there was no funding in the 15 budget for this toner, for the printer. So this is, they've been kind of realigning within that division the entire year. So now they've actually forgot to put it in the request. So this is really an appeal to increase their funding by $3,200 for toner.
A lot of money for toner.
Wow. Toner's expensive.
Toner's expensive.
I think it's a color printer.
Yeah.
So that might be. So they have real.
It's cheaper to buy a second
must
color printer.
Must be a color printer. Yeah.
Must be a color printer.
Actually put new toner.
Okay.
And that's on page 10 and 11. The next item is from Human Resources, and that's on page 12 and 13. And they're requesting $30,000 increase for compensation study consultant costs for the sheriff's office. That was something that we you guys discussed and recommended that they will now look at the sworn officers. And you can see that I have the italics there. Fund balance can be used because this is a study. It's a one-time only cost. So that's an opportunity to use some fund balance to help pay for it. Page 5, the next page, also Human Resources, a consultant for Americans with Disabilities Act, ADA study, for $14,000. And you can see information on that on page 14 and 15.
Ms. Cudmore?
Yes.
I have a question on from Human Resources. Underneath says Consultants for America with Disabilities Act study.
Yeah, that's just typo. I'm sorry about that.
Oh, that's fine. But
okay.
Not the whole thing, right?
No, just the one word.
Okay. So I'm looking at its proposed amount to be $40,500.
No, actually the increase is $14,000.
Okay, so it's an increase of $14,000 over the $26,000. You know, looking at it, I think it would be more beneficial than paying a consultant. You know, we have a part-time ADA employee right now. It would be more beneficial to the county just to hire a full-time ADA coordinator and have them do the assessment and the study, find somebody with that skill set instead of paying a consultant and then having to hire somebody.
You're saying a part-time employee?
Well, I know we have a part-time employee now that is handling the ADA as a collateral duty. Mm-hmm. However,
you're talking about hiring a full-time
do
the study?
They can do the study. We can find somebody that's qualified to do it. There's plenty of people out there that go to school specifically for this rather than paying money to a consultant. We'd already have somebody that's on board from the beginning, finding out what issues we do and do not have. Then they can address them accordingly.
Sure.
This does answer a concern that came from the committee that we're not
exactly
staffing the ADA. Mm-hmm. I think what we would need is from Human Resources what a comparison would be.
Classify the position.
Yeah.
And bring back.
She's back there.
Yeah.
She's back there waving her hands there.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
Good afternoon, Commissioners. I did take the liberty in the event that you wanted to entertain that idea to classify a position to do the ADA coordinator work as a regular FTE, and that would be classified at a grade 7. A step 1 plus fringe would be at about $57,000.
Less fringe?
Plus. That would include fringe. I'm sorry.
$57,000 includes fringe for full-time
fringe. Includes fringe, yes.
Versus the $40,000 consultant cost.
The consultant was $14,000, but that was really just to do an assessment to see, you know, what it is, where we might fall short or have any gaps. So if you'd like to entertain that idea, that's what we classified it as.
Thank you.
I'd like to entertain that, being the fact it's been brought up to us.
I'll second it. I think it has most, it has value.
Versus allocating the money to a consultant. We can have somebody.
We're reallocating with $40,500.
Well, we're talking about hiring another employee, right?
Hire somebody. Yeah.
You know, that's institutional. Once you get them, you got them. You know, it's not like you can say consultant, you get done with the consultant, see you later.
Yeah, we're still going to need somebody to implement their policies and recommendations.
We talked about the issue with the public safety and how we could maybe co-locate that. I'd like to do a little bit more thinking about that. Mm-hmm. I mean, we're not talking about hiring somebody today.
Oh, first of the year.
Yeah, probably July.
Well, I guess, but same thing. I mean, hiring somebody today to start effective on a date.
Yeah.
Or it can be delayed, we can hire
them. I mean, we can do delayed hiring, but, you know, right now we do have somebody that's doing it as a collateral duty part-time. However, the county our size, from our board and commission, they did recommend to us that we have a full-time ADA coordinator to address all of that. And I just can't see wasting money on a consultant to come back and give us recommendations that we could just move forward now and hire the full-time ADA coordinator based on the recommendation from our board, and they can do the full assessment, and they're right there on the ground level implementing the policies and procedures, so we're not behind the power curve another year.
Is there any timing issue that we're not aware of for the timing for actually doing the study with a consultant?
Sue?
Other than just being in the budget for next year, is there timing for something that needs to be connected?
We do need to do an assessment of our facilities in county government to make sure that we're in compliance with the updated regulations. But it obviously wouldn't be done, you know, right away. But we would like to have that done this year if possible. One of the other options is if we did hire, I could see the going either way, quite frankly, but if we did hire a consultant, they could possibly do that assessment for us. So that is an option to consider as well.
So that, but it doesn't tie into any potential grant dollars from any other agency that has a time frame?
No.
Okay, thank you.
Is this our Title V ADA assessment, self-assessment that's required?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Well, maybe we can put this off to a later time. Just
yeah, I think that'll hold off.
Yeah.
Well, you get a motion in a second, Mr.
June, President. June time frame or something?
Yeah, I'd just like to remove the money for the consultant. And
Here's maybe a suggestion. Maybe we earmark the money for now, and then we don't have to implement it right away. And then we come back to the next hearing session after we had a little bit of time to look at it.
So you're saying we can budget it now, it goes in, it doesn't have to necessarily
doesn't
be executed.
Doesn't have to necessarily be spent.
Yeah.
That makes more sense.
Yeah, I can agree with that. And this way we can just take a little bit more time to look at implementing the one full-time FTE for the ADA coordinator.
So since you introduced the idea, do you want to produce a new modify your motion?
Sure. We'll leave it in the budget as is with no execution, pending further discussion on one full-time FTE for the county ADA coordinator.
I'll second it.
You wanted it to 57,000 then?
Right, at the classification given by Ms. Sable.
Got a first, a second?
I'll second that.
Everybody agree?
Aye.
I got
aye.
No.
I'm going to no. Got a no?
Yeah.
Okay, so we're adding the FTE for $57,000. Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. Okay. Let's go, and that, and actually pages 14.
We're adding it for us to see the total picture for future consideration. We'll come back to it at another meeting. I just wanted to make sure.
Okay.
Stays in.
We're going to add the expense in for $57,000
yes.
At this
yes.
point.
Yes, we'll come back and discuss it further.
All right, land use and growth management. We're back on page 5. They have, and if you look at page 16, 17 and 18. They're requesting $4,800 for structural engineer consultant for blight property for inspections and $48,000 for replacement of a plotter for mapping. Plotter continuously breaks down and not able to print software and is no longer compatible. And again, for that plotter, you can use fund balance for that.
Yeah. That's where I go, fund balance for the plotter. What do you think a structural engineer is going to tell us about blight? Looks bad?
I guess. I still hear.
He's consulting.
Is. He's consulting with some.
Yeah, let's just hear about this.
The structural engineer?
Yes.
Since we adopted the blight ordinance, official name property maintenance ordinance, it's been very successful, we think. A lot of people don't, but it takes time to track down owners of some of these blighted properties. Those buildings that are left standing with one or two walls, that's a no-brainer. We knock them down. If we have to, then we can put a lien, as we, the county, could put a lien on the property and recoup the money. We had one case a couple weeks ago where it was borderline. The our code people back at Luggum wanted some professional input on this one particular house that could have gone either way. It's really bad shape. So we did we got a hold of a structural engineer, and he declared the structure irreparably damaged. A lot of times we find that these structures that really look bad, the owners will come in and try to get a permit to renovate them. And not deceitfully, but maybe just in their mind thinking they'd like to fix this particular, any particular structure up, but we know that it's really beyond repair. So to cut to the chase, having a structural engineer's input will take some liability away from the county if we decide to have a structure removed, so they can't come back on us, the property owners.
Okay. So it's kind of like a, we can look at somebody else and said, they're engineers, they're experts, and on their recommendation, we're doing it.
Yeah, and they're certified too, so we can put that in our file. So that would, it's more or less to protect the county. And 4,800, I don't know how many inspections that would cover, but it's a start to see how it works out.
It says six properties at $800
okay.
a day.
Okay.
And would that be recurring, Bill?
From our experience, yes. Couldn't tell you how often we've run across it, a couple times. And we've used the engineer's input once.
Mr. Chair, I spent yesterday afternoon walking around Leonardtown, specifically the area back in there where that new library is going to be located. There's several places back there that have blight.
Is that a Freudian slip there?
Was that a Freudian slip?
Yeah, it was a Freudian slip.
Okay.
Yeah. Bottom line is, I was in that area, and there's a lot of blight back there. And, you know, you got some areas back here that need some attention. So is that something appropriate for, like, a commissioner to bring to your attention, or is that something you guys do on yourself?
Well, in the first place, that would be within corporate limits of Leonardtown, so it would be in their jurisdiction. But we have, I don't think it's written in the actual property maintenance ordinance, but we have more or less a set policy that we will respond only to complaints from neighbors and so on. Otherwise, there'd
but,
be no way.
Does Leonardtown have their own blight ordinance? Is it,
I don't
is ours,
so. I don't know, but I have not heard of such.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Okay. Any other questions about blight? The plotter?
So good to go with that?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Everybody good to go
yeah.
with that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Plotter's expensive.
Yeah.
On page, the next item is from Recreation and Parks. Now, again, remember, we're talking about the general fund. This is actually related to when we get back to the enterprise fund as part of the reduction that you guys asked them to identify. But this is the complement part of it that is in the general fund. One of the items, they actually have the director and the fiscal specialist, part of their salaries is charged to the Wicomico golf course. If we correct that or change it in the Wicomico, we would need to charge their salaries back so that 100% of their salary is charged to the general fund. To do that would increase the general fund by $22,995. And that would be consistent on how we're handling the other enterprise funds, just like solid waste. You know, George Erickson's not charged to that fund. It's just, you know, the employees that are in that fund. So we would eliminate that charging to the Wicomico of the director and the fiscal specialist.
Are there any other areas where the salary is shared with other programs?
Not with the
just this one particular.
Yes.
Makes sense to me.
There were some special things like that in the Wicomico, and that's
okay.
What we're proposing to change.
Okay.
So, okay. And that was on page 19 and also on page 20, discussion. The next item, I think the sheriff is here, or representative. It's an increase of $17,500. Now, if you remember, when we were going through the recommended, there was a Southern Maryland Criminal Justice Academy. They're going to have a contract director. And the cost that was going to be proposed for each county was $35,000, for a total cost of $105,000. I actually heard from Calvert County's Director of Finance, and they called and told me that actually it's going to be $52,500 for Calvert and St. Mary's County because Charles County is unable to fund it in their 16 budget.
Okay.
So the $17,500 is being split between the two counties to make our share now $52,500. Okay. I think Charles County is saying that they'll hopefully be able to fund it next year in 17.
Is there a waiting list for deputies from the various counties to go? Yeah, America?
Uh,
I think we all can agree that with attrition, there's constant openings for us to put people into the academy. And once, you know, they're in the academy, it's 6 months. So we're perpetually having academies back-to-back with both law enforcement and corrections. St. Mary's County is one of the better areas as far as, I guess I can be prejudiced in a way that we run our own academy in the Tri-County area. It's a very, very thorough academy, and it gives us the blend for our community and what the community needs are for deputy sheriffs. I personally think that it's money well spent.
Is it equitable between the three counties on the number of deputies or correction officials?
It is. It's very equitable. I mean, this is just a budgetary thing, as you can see this year. But, I mean, as far as personnel up there, we're all pretty much even on the demands, as well as providing support instructors at each academy from our cadre, both on the patrol side and the correction side.
So from Charles County, this is the only reduction they're offering to support?
That I'm aware of, yes.
Okay, thank you.
Is this increase based on the fact that they're just not funding it, so we need to recoup the money for the salary that's in place?
Well, the director is going to cost $105,000. So
So
it was $35,000 per county, which was the $105,000. Now, St. Mary's and Calvert will be $52,500 because Charles County is not funding their share to come to the same $105,000 that's needed.
Are there any measures in place for us to recoup any money from Charles County? Are they going to cut down their quota of deputies going there, et cetera, et cetera? You know, this is – now we're having to shoulder the burden because Charles County is deciding not to, but yet they're going to have an equal share in the facility.
Well, that was kind of the line of reasoning. That was
exactly. That's
– Commissioner, I'm told that it's just for this year. I mean, you know, I'd hate to see, and I'm sure the sheriff, he was standing here to tell you that to – barter just this little bit and not have an academy up there and having to send people to elsewhere to be trained would cost us a lot more money than this.
And that's what I was told too. It was like a 1 year thing that they would actually be funding it in the next year.
Seems like a county as large as Charles wouldn't have as much of an issue with that little amount of money. So I guess I'm curious if there's some underlying reason they're not funding it this year.
They're raising taxes.
And they're raising,
taxes, and they can't afford the $17,000. Okay.
I would just like to see something, and I'm okay with this, but I would like to see some line or measure for us to recoup this money from Charles County next year.
Okay.
As in, we won't fund it next year, or something along those lines.
Or
Charles County.
We have a reduced funding, and they have a
right.
So their share will increase in 17, and ours might reduce for the same, so that we'll end up being even after a couple years.
Exactly.
Okay. Of course, Captain American, not to the threat of not having the academy, but just.
No, we're going to fund it. We're going to have it.
But equity.
Yeah.
All right. I'll look into that for you. All right. Now we have two items on here from the state boards and agencies. The first one is from the Board of Education. They submitted a request on March 19th. For $1.6 million to pay off a lease that's in their budget. The majority of it is in 2016, and 526 will be in 2017.
Right.
They would like for us to pay that off. Actually, the request came in, and they wanted us to use funding in 2015. But we're proposing to use it in 2016 so that we can use fund balance for it and also include it as a excludable cost when we resubmit at the end of the month.
I support that. Do it on July 2nd.
Right, and this will free up. There's that $1,073,000 that will actually free up and remain in their budget allocation.
I'm good with that. Yeah. You have a question?
I would. For the time being, I'm okay. I have something else we'll discuss when it comes to 1.9.
And to be clear, it's coming out of fund balance.
Okay. I thought you were going to say something.
You want me
it's
to
It's
going to
come out of fund balance.
Yeah.
Should we
discuss, or would you like to discuss the 1.9 now or come back later?
I think it's the perfect time to discuss it versus getting down the road and off track.
Right. The 1.9.
The
in Mr. Smith's discussion, one of the concerns he had raised, and Scott, correct me when I'm wrong, that one of the biggest concerns you have getting the 1.6 was to combine it with the 1.1 or whatever it was to also help to begin negotiations with the union relative to health care costs and moving it up a little bit with the steps, if I remember correctly. I got that sort of right?
Yes, that was the discussion that we had at the last opportunity I had to speak to you.
Simultaneously, that would be a recognizing in the past how negotiations have gone, it's always been a little bit tenuous. And Mr. Clements remembers one time I said, you better negotiate hard and again before your watch. But we have $1.9 million now coming from the state, additional to your budget, if I remember reading correctly.
No.
The state was 1.9, what did it say? Jeanette.
Yeah. Right. So as of right now, we are anticipating 1.1 to 1.2 additional $1 million worth of additional resources that we could ultimately put to recurring costs.
I'll read this from page 2. With the closing of legislative session last week, state aid for education appears to have increased by an additional $1.9 million above the state funding included in the Board of Education's request. So that's the information that I have on the 1.9 that we were given.
Right. It was on state aid to local governments, the information. That's also in the 90-day report.
Yes.
Shows an increase of $2.3 million. And we already had $436,000 in the recommended budget showing. That's actually on page 31 in your recommended budget.
And keep in mind that with ultimately, we get state funding not from the state, but from the Maryland State Department of Education, which then takes the state award and uses their translation and ultimately their formula. And we have not received, unless I'm mistaken, we do not know what our final state dollars are. We were to hear that on Friday, and we did not hear that on Friday. And to the best of our calculation, with Mrs. McCourt going up and speaking, she came back and she said that that was looking to be $1.2 million. Now, perhaps we're misguided and something has happened and we are to receive $1.9 million that we could ultimately put to recurring costs from the state. That would be fantastic news.
Well, my point here is that whether it become 1.2 or 1.9, I'm using the 1.9 because that's the information the commissioners were given, that you'll get somewhere between 1.2 or $1.9 million for recurring costs next year. That 1.2 and or 1.9 comes out of our contribution to you, so it's a wash. We contribute the $1.6 million for what you need to get whatever you need to have done on your side of the equation so that we're moving forward in a positive manner next year across the board with steps, healthcare negotiations, et cetera, and show that this board is acting in good faith for that.
Right.
That's my point.
Good point.
I do agree with that.
Okay. Because as I understand it, this board, in the initial conversation we had, we were talking about $2.3 million over funding last year, 2.3 and change. We then came back with the identified excludable costs of about $375,000. So we're at about $2 million over where we were funded last year. We then are given the latitude to take our OPEB contribution of $2 million that had been paid after the fact, and we were allowed to then use that for recurring costs, which puts me at about $4 million over where I am this year in recurring costs. Now, from that $4 million, we would like to open a new school, cover health care costs, and negotiate in good faith. When I was before you before, I said, well, let's creatively take a look at some of our expenses and fund balance items that we could also identify that would give a little bit of flexibility. So the $1.6 million does, if it comes out of fund balance, does give us another $1 million to play with for next year. That now I'm at about $5 million that I have that we can open a new school, take care of health care costs, and negotiate in good faith. When I came before you at the public hearing, I talked about the $675,000 that was put aside in public reserve. With that money and the $1.6 million in one-time fund balance, we would be able to go back and negotiate in good faith. And I do believe that I've been fairly forthright that our employees are two steps behind through no fault of their own, and ultimately, in negotiating with them, we would like them to be able to recover as much as they possibly can. And I believe that that's also the general disposition of the county commissioners. We want to make sure that our employees are finding themselves where they should be.
So you'll still need $675,000 more dollars
at the end of it. Well, unless
we don't know what the 1.6 or 1.2 or 1.9 is.
Yeah, I mean, if the state comes back and we're getting $1.9 million, that's $700,000 more than we anticipated. And at that point, it would certainly change the disposition.
Yeah.
If it comes back at 1.2, which is what we forecast it to be through every communication that's come to us, we are $700,000 short to do what we had hoped to do through negotiations.
When are you going
to
know?
Well, we should have known on Friday, but they didn't give us that information on Friday, and we're still... I keep on looking over there to Ms. McCourt.
Okay, because we got another budget work session next Monday.
Yeah. So we can defer the discussion on the education until we find out what the real numbers are.
Absolutely.
I would make it clear that the $682,373, as far as I'm concerned, is off the table for the schools because we have other county employees and other things that we need to take care of to allocate that funding.
And I would agree with the Commissioner O'Connor, but I wouldn't take it all off the table.
Well, not all of it, but the full amount in itself is unrealistic to allocate based on discussions that we've had for funding.
Well, then what are we? Smith, I'm committed to that two steps because I think that's something we can get to.
At the end of the day, anything that we can creatively do working together to get to that is my singular goal.
Mine too.
Yeah. I think it's important for the public to be aware that the new superintendent and the school board have been working very hard to think out of the box. This is not any grandiose, we have to have this or this isn't going to happen. They've not played that card at all.
No.
And we've had a great dialogue with them. So I appreciate it. And let's keep the conversation going. We need a little bit more information.
Absolutely. And if we get news from the state that we have a $1.9 million coming down, then that'll be fantastic.
And maybe some of the rhetoric in the community can die down now a little bit too. That's being...
Please, let's hope. Yes.
Please, I would ask that the rhetoric just die down a little bit. That just like the library, the school board rhetoric is heating itself up as the library. So let's just calm down a little bit. Please.
Absolutely. Thank you. Continue to have the great relationships that we've started this year, and we will end this year.
All right.
Thank you.
All right. So we'll defer that until next week's discussion,
yep.
And then hopefully we'll get better numbers from the state. And the next item is for $262,339 for CSM to help fund their indirect cost.
Now, I believe we don't actually are responsible for this 262, the way it was put to us in this form of everybody's got to chip in their share. But I want to give them the 262 because I definitely believe that what they're doing is a benefit to this community. But I also want to say, let's find out why enrollment is tailing off. Let's address the key problem. I mean, enrollment's up, revenues are up, enrollment's down. Let's find out why. We're also hearing the same thing with the Higher Ed Center, that enrollment's down. So that's something we need to drill down in and find out the root cause of that.
Okay.
I think I'd like to add on to that. We've said it, it's well known, education is the great equalizer, and CSM is a great deal. It's not just an affordable college, it's a great deal, and we should do our share to make sure they help them out. As Commissioner Morgan and I were discussing, Dr. Godfrey doesn't come in front of the board asking for money unless he needs it, and I appreciate that. I do think my observations of the economy, given the governor's budget and what he had to go through, the state-funded schools are not going to get the same subsidies they'd got in the past for tuition, so I think the court is going to have a self-realizing course correction next year, and I think enrollment's going to go up because it's just going to be too darn expensive to send your kids to other state schools. It's just the reality of the economy. The Higher Education Center, I think, still sees a reduction in enrollment because it's extra money that the defense community was paying towards continuing education for higher education degrees. And given the sequestration that's ongoing, I think higher education has much more struggles in the future than I think College of Southern Maryland is. But I agree. CSM is a great partner for the county commissioners. It's a great deal for us. We should invest in it fully, and I fully support the 262 request. Thank you.
Okay.
Agreed.
Agree.
All right.
I agree as well.
Now let's just hope that our friends in Charles and Calvert can belly up to the bar.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. The last I had heard, Calvert County wasn't able to. So.
Yeah, they've got, well, both counties have some issues.
Yeah. Okay, great. Well, that's all the changes that are proposed for the general fund. Would you like to give direction now on the general fund before we go to the enterprise funds?
It's just.
I did receive some direction, but.
Well, recapping it, the changes that we talked about were the ADA coordinator potentially going
yes.
to an FTE.
Correct. We're going to put $57,000 in the budget at this point and come back later and discuss with that more info on the position.
The Board of Education discussion being deferred.
Until next week? Right. Yes, until we know more.
That's what I cried.
Well, and the Board of Education part, I also want to bring up the school bus drivers. Now, we've had an outreach from their group that I think it's $180,000 would fund them a 2% increase in wages plus some, I think, 2 cents on maintenance. I think that's something I want to look at, too. I'm in favor of that.
On top of that, I'd like to know, better understand the private or the schools that there's some contracted employees who are in a different schedule. And I don't quite understand that. I know some of them seem to be school employees and some are not, or they're in different buckets. Some are private contractors. I'd like to understand how they get their increases, because we've certainly received a lot of information on going 5 years plus without having any type of
yes,
okay. So more information.
Were they being held in parity with the STS bus?
George is here.
But I think the issue, Commissioner President Guy, was that these school bus drivers tend to be more part-time than
True.
The STS.
True.
And the STS, you know, they work year-round, where the school bus people, they're off, you know, of course, on holidays, and they're off during the summer. So the actual amount that they're making is less than the STS people make.
We have George Erickson here who would like to go over that with you.
Okay.
Yeah, we prepared a memorandum, Commissioners, I think it was dated April 23rd, that discusses the difference between the non-public school bus contractors and the Board of Ed school bus contractors. And historically, we always had issues with trying to keep pace with the wages as well as the maintenance factors. Several years ago, we came up with, I'll call it a formula for the lack of a better term, we agreed that we would supply our non-public school bus contractors with the same benefits as the Board of Ed's contractors, but at a one-year lag.
Okay.
The reason for the one-year lag, because we would go into the budget cycles with two different entities, negotiating at two different times, and never the two would meet, you know, historically. We met with the school bus contractors. They seemed pretty excited about that because they knew, for example, in FY15, what the terms would be in 16. So it gave them certainty, where typically, you know, in the past, they didn't have that certainty. I think the number you're looking for, Commissioner Hewitt, for the Board of Ed, for a 2% increase and a 2 cent per mile maintenance factor is more like $169,000,
$170,000. Oh, is that what it is?
That was the amount we reduced.
Our, if we were to match that this year, which typically we would request an appeal every year if we wanted to match, is only $26,983 to make that same equity, so that in FY16, both the non-public and public school bus contractors would get the same hourly rate based on their years of experience, as well as the same maintenance factor. We had a meeting with our non-public school bus contractors on the 21st. We have this annually. You know, one of the items that came out of the meeting, of course, is let the commissioners know if the Board of Ed gets an increase, we would like an increase in the same year instead of being 1 year behind. So I'm glad I had the opportunity to say that. The fiscal impact is not that great. In addition to that, that increase to get that pay parity, if you will, is less than the decrease in our budget request between 15 and 16. So we could have let the budget be flat between 15 and 16 and would have been able to fund that. But we stuck to our formula where we lag 1 year behind. With respect to STS, they are grant-funded positions as a general rule. We have some part-time. We have some regular part-times. They are county employees. They are benefited employees. Big difference between the two.
Yes.
On the endorsement side, School bus drivers, they need not only the CDL and a passenger endorsement, which is a P endorsement, they also have to have an S endorsement, which is a school bus endorsement. Our STS drivers do not have to do that. And you are correct. STS drivers will drive a continuous loop all day long. As a general rule, our non-public and public school drivers have a morning run and an afternoon run. Their buses hold 60 to 72 people. STS buses typically hold around 16. So you might argue, you can argue either way whether or not they should be paid the same. But as a general rule, the contractors are contractors and the employees are employees. So we pay for those benefits. They're 50% grant funded. And on the other side, we pay a fixed cost, I think, Brad, is 25% over the hourly rate. And we let the contractors worry about the benefit package for their drivers.
So the private contractors have their contracts through the county?
We have a service. We have a service agreement with contractors who supply drivers and buses.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
That's the difference.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, anyway, it makes it fair, right?
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Good.
Yes,
that's sir. Good. That's a good thing. That's good.
Sure. I agree with Commissioner Hewitt and Jarbo. Yeah.
So we can figure out what that. You have the numbers. If we can next look at putting that in for the next
26,983. Next yes, sir. Right.
Yeah, so 169,125 for the Board of Ed bus drivers, and 26,983 for a total of 196,000, almost 200.
But we're also going to see if they're getting 1.9 versus 1.2, right? Because that 700 couldn't.
So should I put that on the changes spreadsheet for further discussion next week?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
So what we would do also in future years, if we weren't quite at the same level, we would submit an appeal each year to match what the Board of Ed's current contract rates are, and you can make the decision on whether or not we want to match it that year or stay 1 year behind. And that way we always have both of those decisions in front of you every fiscal year. And we can make that change really easily.
Good. Sounds good.
Thank you, George.
Sure thing.
I do have some guidance. Actually, I think this would be more directed toward Mr. Kelly and his department. Every year we allocate funding for grants. I would like to see, similar to the Governor's Office of Crime Control and Prevention, GOCAP, their grant management software that they use. Mr. Kelly, I would just like to see some research and maybe some figures on a grant management system or software that we can use to solicit money for the grants versus just allocating them based on advocacy or which particular commissioner feels we should award to this. Not that this happened on this board.
And this would be for the nonprofits?
Yes, it would be. Thank you. This will just allow for accountability. You know, they'll have to report back, have somebody in grant management. You know, we'll see where the funds go. If they don't expend all the funds, we get the funds back. Just how the state does it, more of a structure. Okay. And the awards can be, we're not duplicating services as well. So thank you.
All right. So would you like us to bring back an estimate for next week's?
Yes, I'd like to see
to
an
add
estimate.
To the changes?
Yes, please.
Spreadsheet?
Yes. I'm hoping that we can piggyback off something the state already has, similar to the GOCAP management system.
Can you all find that by next week? Is that you enough time?
Is that possible, Mr. Kelly?
I'll do my best.
Okay.
That's all we can ask. Okay. Thank you.
Any other direction in the general fund?
Yeah, the last thing I'd like to talk about is the men and women of the FOP came out to our public hearing in reference to their second step increase. Normally, I think that costs about $188,000 for a second step increase, which would bring them current to where they are, or current because they haven't had their full step increases. They've been left behind. What I recommend is removing the stipends from all sheriff's office employees that they've been getting, $500 stipend, and I believe some in upper levels have been getting $1,000.
$1,500.
Yes, I think it's up to $1,500.
So remove all the prior stipends that they've received.
Right, and remove the stipends moving forward. I believe that total came out to roughly $80,000, something along those lines every year they've been getting the stipend. Consolidate that money into the step increase, which we would be taking roughly $108,000 for the step increase.
Mm-hmm.
And then for those that are not eligible for a step increase because they've been maxed out, whether it's a corporal, sergeant, lieutenant, whatever the rank may be, based on human resources recommendation of a COLA versus a just straight stipend. So I don't know what that percentage should be. However, the second step increase should be pulled out of that 682 as well.
So we have to do the calculation by next Tuesday.
Yeah, we're going to need the calculation.
I think it's around 100K, right?
Yeah, rough estimates based on pulling the stipends out. It comes to about 100,000 that we'd have to allocate. Yeah, and then I don't know what how many employees are maxed out from the sheriff's office that cannot receive a step increase, and how that a COLA would affect that.
How it's equitable for them too.
Right.
Right. Okay. Yeah, I may need to get some more information on how to calculate this, because when they receive the stipends, the other county employees also received the stipends at that time, and
right.
So you want to remove the prior stipends just from the sworn officers.
Correct.
Which became actually they and actually a lot of the stipends, only one stipend became permanent over the years. That was like a $500 stipend. The
right,
rest of them were like temporary. They only got it like for most of them were just mainly for the longevity for top of grade employees. So not all the sworn received a stipend, only if they were at top of grade.
Okay, good. Yeah, that's the ones that I saw in the paperwork. It said $500 stipend or $1,500 stipend, and it had a.
And it was only 1 year that we actually all the employees got a $500 stipend.
Okay, so yeah. I guess we'd have
and
to.
Then it
reassess.
Became permanent, right? And then it became permanent for all the employees where we grew the pay scales by that $500.
I don't think you can remove the permanent.
Yeah, I'm not so sure.
Yeah, temporary.
Yeah. Unless we remove and reduce the pay scale, and I'm not sure.
No, if it's already been incorporated, then we're at. Needs more research. So we are where we are if it's already been incorporated.
Yes.
However, if that's still the case, I still want to see the second step.
So the cost of a second step.
Yes.
Okay.
Well, yeah, I think it's roughly 188. And then for the top level employees that are maxed out, I mean, whether they're top level or not, some sort of COLA.
I can actually run that upstairs and provide that to you next week.
That's perfect. Yeah, that's great.
And one, if it's not one last thing, one additional thing, to move to constant yield would cost us about $400,000.
$543,000, I think, is what might.
$543,000.
Yeah, something like that.
And that would reduce our property tax by 0.75, something like that.
Yeah.
When I looked in the paper and it said we're raising taxes, I didn't like that. I'd like to put that on the table for us to talk about. It's Monday too.
Okay. We can do that. So constant yield. I think that was
0.8523. Yes. Because I think it's 0.87.
Right. Well, last year was 0.85.
It was a small amount.
It was a small amount. Okay. So that would actually be a reduction to property tax that I'll bring back next week.
Yes.
Okay. Anything else in the general fund?
Could I? Yeah, I think the executive committee of the Tri-County Council met last Thursday to discuss a variety of issues, and one of them was a second phase of the joint land use study, which was an implementation phase, and the cost was $30,000. To be shared between the three counties, which will be a $10,000 cost to St. Mary's. Commissioner Davis from Charles was supportive, but she had to go back to her board, and Delegate Fisher was going to be talking to Commissioner Weems relative to Calvert County. I think we're the first ones in the queue since last Thursday to meet to discuss budget. So I'd like to support the executive board, the Tri-County Council's request for each of the counties to put up $10,000 and put that request to our board to move forward.
What do we do if Charles doesn't do it or Calvert doesn't do it?
Everyone's thinking.
You know, that's a good question.
Exactly. We're all thinking.
Yeah.
I don't have an answer. I'm just saying that was what the discussion was on Thursday.
Well, is our $10,000 enough to move forward, or does it?
It's a $30,000 bill.
Yeah. So the point is, $10,000 doesn't move if they don't.
No,
do
but
it.
I just we put in the budget and it doesn't move, then we doubt.
I'd suggest you put in the budget, and when Charles County Commissioners meet, they'll know that it's our budget, and if they fail to come through, then the study's off and the money.
And the same with Calvert.
Yep.
I agree. Yeah. That's my request to say we did it in good faith and move forward and
But we're not funding their portion.
No.
Under the idea they'll pay us back next year.
We give our, we put up our 10.
Once, but we're not doing it twice.
We put up our 10 and.
Should I add that to the changes sheet for next week, or should we just go ahead and do it? Do I have consensus?
Put it in. If it doesn't fly, it's out. I mean.
Okay, so add.
Please.
Continue
to do the budget for Tri-County Council.
Commissioner Warren, tell me, what is that going to tell us? What's the $30,000?
The next phase of the $30,000 is to begin to, through the, for the Office of Economic Adjustment, to work with the entire region, which includes Eastern Shore, Western Panhandle, or Northern Neck and ourselves, to implement some of the comments per county that have been made in the joint land use study, such as we're doing now as we provide input to the Lexington Park Planning Commission for that piece of the joint land use study that pertains to Lexington Park.
Okay, I remember, wasn't too long ago, I thought JLUS had been canceled.
No, joint land use study was done, finished, it's in the books.
Okay, I just thought I remember hearing saying one time that JLUS was canceled.
No, JLUS, the study is done, completed, written, and now it's implementation time.
Okay.
I doubt this comes out of enterprise funds. Are we good on that before I switch to the
ready for enterprise?
I don't know if this comes out.
That's a general fund.
No, the equipment purchase. Actually, or looking into the equipment purchase. Okay, all right. Well, I'll just wait.
Okay.
Are you ready?
Yeah.
Now, there were other changes. Are you okay with those in the general fund?
Yeah.
The hourly 1% reclassifications, the realignment, the toner, the study for 30, the plotter, and the other items. Okay. All right. Sounds good. All right, let's go back, and you'll see we're starting with the enterprises. Let's go to page 33. This is the Recreation and Parks Enterprise Fund. And currently on 427, you can see it looks like the same sheet that was in the recommended budget book. And if you're wanting to, I can show you where that is. Page 63 in the recommended budget book. And we included the column, second from the right. That was what was in there, the recommended. And now we have a new column, which is as of 4/27 today. And the asterisk on the bottom shows includes a decrease of $14,413 due to compensation-related changes. So that's already in there.
That's hourly.
No, that's not for the hourly. That's actually for changes that we made that we had, and I think a lot of that was corrections too. I think one we had to add more FICA and workers' comp, and this one I think we had too much. So we actually put those changes in here to reflect the amount that needs to be. So those are already in there, and that's a decrease. But what we're proposing to add is $19,594 for the hourly employees to receive a 1% increase. And they do have a fund equity, you can see that, of $366,505.
But I think, make sure everyone's clear on a fund equity balance, that is not based upon last year, that is based upon
June 30, 2014.
Correct.
Correct.
But it's not a one-year balance. It's
right.
It's an equity balance
multiple.
That's been built up over time.
Exactly.
Thank you.
Well, before we move to the individual departments, one thing I just wanted to address, and a few of the commissioners, we have already met with the parents and had some in-depth conversations in reference to the gymnastics department. I think Mr. Lowy is here. Mr. Lowy, I would, for our next hearing, if you could, please, I would like to have some information on the equipment located at our gymnastics center as to an assessment of what may need to be replaced, whether it's mats, it's horse, rings, et cetera, and have it on a priority scale so we can take a look at that and see what we need to do to get that up to par of where we need to be. For a lack of better words. I know you're meeting with the parents, again, that we've set that up for Friday, or you've set that up for Friday, and we have single points of contact So I think that's a good time and gives you enough time to come back to us. So when we come back to the next budget hearing, we can go ahead and look at where we need to, or where we need to allocate funds from in order for the that purchase that equipment, if necessary.
Okay, so we'll bring that back.
And I would also say in that prioritize the need of the equipment, because if you come back with a $500,000 list, obviously it's not going anywhere. So we go from there, please.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Any direction on the 1% increase? We'll wait and we'll discuss
next week
also.
Yes, please.
Yes.
Okay. All right, let's turn to page 34. This is the Wicomico Shores Golf Enterprise Fund, and in the recommended budget book, it was page 64. Now, in your recommended budget, in their request, they asked for a subsidy. I'll start from that point, and from the general fund. And it's based on, if you look at the 2014 actual on the bottom, you can see they have a deficit fund equity at the end of 2014. Of $36,000. You did not approve to have a subsidy come from the general fund. You requested that they come back and show how they can reduce expenditures of $70,000. They did that. There was several meetings taking place, and actually they identified more than
$70,000.
Yeah. Okay. So what we'll do first, before we get to those changes, just like what we've done already, we have new numbers and new totals as of the day, which reflects, if you see the little asterisk, increase of $25,039 due to compensated related changes. They actually have, for their employees, I think there was one position that might have been reclassified, and there was some others, corrections. I think we needed to add more FICA and workers' comp for the hourlies, so to make sure that they had enough money to do to pay their employees now, the current ones that are in there, without any changes. We did increase the compensation-related expenses by $25,039. Okay? Now, they had in their request an additional amount of like $13,000. That is not needed because that's included in that $25,000. All right? And I know I probably got ahead of myself there. Below are proposed changes. They're proposing to increase their revenue by $6,700 as part of this change. When they went back and looked at their fund. So they can increase their revenue by $6,700. And they've identified reductions. And if you go, they have, you can see that there's a memo from Brian Lowy that starts on page 35. And on the top of page 36, he's identified actually seven items. The first three represent $68,800. But I'm going to have you turn to the next few pages here. Just bear with me. They're proposing the total changes that they're proposing to reduce is $127,399. But that includes what is on page 43, the increase of $13,797. They don't need to do that right now because I've already increased it when we were doing our calculations upstairs. That is already included in the 427 draft. All right? So realistically, they've identified credits of $141,196 that can be reduced as far as expenses. And now we can go back to his memo. Page 36. The first item, number one, is to reduce the OPEB contributions to the commissioners by $31,000. Just like in the general fund, you're only doing the PAYGO. We can do PAYGO for them too. That's a savings of $31,000. Mm-hmm. Okay. Two is an elimination of $11,600. That's where the Department of Human Resources will be able to handle, they're going to move the insurance, the liability insurance, to the just like the other funds. That can be moved. Three, eliminate the charges for accounting services from the golf course operating funds. And it says these charges originated in early years when the golf course was managed by an outside operator and accounting was heavily involved, with commissions and fees to be reimbursed. This would be consistent on how, so apparently there was a charge that was actually for the accounting services upstairs, for us to pay their bills and also to process their payroll. We are making a monthly journal entry, and it's revenue in the general fund, but it was being charged as an expenditure to the Wicomico. They're proposing to stop this. Now, that will reduce revenue in the general fund of the same amount, $26,200. We're not doing, and that process has changed. There is nobody receiving any commissions anymore. I mean, that ended, I think, actually before I started, and it's been continued. So they're proposing to stop this monthly journal entry.
Makes sense, doesn't it?
Yes.
Yeah.
Probably should have been stopped a long time ago.
Sure.
Okay. The fourth item is to eliminate the fees charged to the golf course operating funds for a percentage of the recreation and park staff salaries. This is where I was talking about the complement part that's in the general fund, where we had to increase them because we're not doing this in any other enterprise fund. So we're going to keep those that are like the director and the fiscal person. They're going to be charged 100% in the general fund and not charged to the Wicomico.
Okay.
And that is consistent. Number five, eliminate the interest on the interfund loan and require that the golf enterprise fund pay only the principal back to the county. When the golf course, the clubhouse was built, it was actually a lease with SunTrust, and the county in 2012 paid that lease off.
Oh, so it's pay. It was, we eliminated it,
well,
but we're still collecting
loan right now. But we were, the general fund was charging the Wicomico interest. I think it's like 2.48%.
Why didn't we exclude the interest?
Right. Why don't we? So this is proposing to remove the interest and just have them pay back the general fund without the interest.
Yeah, that kind of makes sense.
Yeah.
Okay. And number six, staff has identified line item reductions, and I think those can actually be seen better if we go to page. I think it's 42. Supplies and materials can be reduced $1,000. Equipment rental by $500. Hourly employees, $8,098. I think they're just going to reduce some of the hours. Supplies and more supplies and materials. Now, the reason why I'm saying it twice, because there's different divisions. Irrigation, $1,500 for equipment rental, $400 for non-capital equipment. Janitorial services of $4,100 and more supplies and materials of $3,000 for a total reduction that they've identified within just by reducing expenditures of $24,598.
Okay, I guess my initial reaction would be, why wouldn't this done earlier? I mean, this is, you know,
right.
I mean, if you don't need it, why are we paying it?
Should have been done.
But are we going to have a loss in quality of service? And that's probably for Mr. Lowy to answer.
Right. Brian?
Yes, I think that last item potentially could affect quality of service there. That's why it was the last one identified. As far as staffing goes, everyone's pitched in and tried to reduce hours or reduce part-time staff or supplies and materials. So we went through and looked at each individual division within that, well, sub-department within that division, I would say, and tried to identify different ways to save costs, and that's what everyone stepped up and tried to do. I would hate to see that happen, and you reduce hours, and then you have some type of effect on operations up there as far as maintenance goes in the greens and grounds or things of that nature.
Well, that would be my concern, too, is that you actually influence the quality of somebody's golf experience. So maybe on that $24,000, And thank you. You've identified a lot of savings here. But it sounds like this last one may be something you can have a little bit of discretion on, but given the board's approval, I think you could have a, you know, look, let's not compromise quality of service.
Yes, sir.
You know? And we're not reducing any hours, are we?
This is not, well, potentially you could reduce some hours in the wintertime, but on a golf course operation, it's hard to reduce hours.
So you want to, we want to maximize availability, which would generate obviously more revenue.
Yes.
I think as Commissioner Hewitt said, when I see that, you know, we're going to reduce janitorial from the 3 to 5 or something, 5 to 3?
From 5 to 3, yeah.
Yeah, again, is the place going to be cleanly enough, decent enough that the person's not going to say, well, geez, you turn that place into a dump?
Yes, that's
the I would be concerned that, you know, remember, this is an enterprise fund, and there are services that we provide to our residents, and sometimes, you know, you're up and sometimes you're down, but the enterprise fund is to balance out and provide enough amenities for the population as a whole.
Yes.
I just want to make sure we don't get a tarnished name where it says, I'm going to White Plains.
Right. That would be our last recommended item on the list.
I think the key in the janitorial services is that's mid-season, so you're talking about basically winter.
No, actually, that would be right during season.
During season?
So, yeah,
okay.
So you're reducing.
All right, so you're talking, okay.
Not optimal. I mean, you'd rather have 5 days a week versus three.
Yeah, that I think that, you know, I can't see reducing, you know, July, August, June, good playing times, reducing janitorial services, and people start to get disgruntled with the facility.
Right. You could look at hours of operation in the off season in the winter months, which was what we looked at, you know, the December, January, February, when things are low operational side. Golf course, it's hard to reduce operational hours on the golf operations side because the golf course is there. People are still going to possibly show. If you're not open, potentially they're going to go out on the course and play anyway without any revenue. We were thinking probably Riverview Restaurant there for some limited hours, certain days of the week.
Well, you got to give you the latitude to make operational changes as makes sense. And I guess where I go with this is, you know, I'm one of the guys who said, hey, look, you guys got to tighten up out there. You're losing too much money. But we're charging you interest on money that we're not paying interest on. You know, maybe it was a little heavy-handed. Maybe we lighten up on you a little bit. But thanks for doing everything you've done.
Sure. Thank you.
Did a good job, Brian. Appreciate it.
Yeah, I agree. Sometimes it takes that a little bit of a heavy hand, or if however you want to call it, to stop the bleeding and to bring stuff to light. And I think you've done an outstanding job here, finding key resources that were, I don't want to say misallocated, but could have been handled a lot better. And they've come to light, taken care of them. And I agree with Commissioner Hewitt. You know, you need some latitude to adjust, and so be it. We don't want the quality to suffer.
Of the experience, yes.
Yeah, especially in prime time. Yeah. Golf's right there in the summer.
So should I work with Mr. Lowy and maybe identify and see if we can reduce or see what really that $24,598 should be?
Yeah, we'll find out where latitude needs to be gained, you know.
Yeah.
Okay.
We'll do that for the next week and bring that back.
That's great.
And we'll make the other changes. And that also has the 1% increase for hourly employees. If you want that to go forward, or we can talk about that next week.
I think we should go forward.
Yeah, I'm okay with that.
Give that one.
That too, yeah.
Okay. All right, let me see where I'm at here. Solid Waste and Recycling Fund on page 44. And that's on page 65 in the recommended budget book. Again, this has the same columns that the other ones do. The recommended shows the expenditures of $4,034,000 and the revenue at $3,990,000. Direction was received last week on the 21st that the proposed rate increase will be deferred until 2017 or will be looked at because of the $1.6 million fund equity.
Yes.
Okay. So you can see on the 427 column, there is a zero in place of where the million was. Okay?
I just have to say, I know we made the decision, but for the record, I disagree wholeheartedly with that decision because the money and the math that was used to get the $84 is exactly what the citizens are paying now, the $84. So this funding that we're allocating, you know, Mr. Erickson didn't pull the numbers out of nowhere. So I just think it's a mistake moving forward and pushing it down the road. So just for the record, so the citizens know where I stand with this, is that this money should have, I believe, it should have been allocated elsewhere, and we shouldn't be kicking this down the road.
Okay. Also included in the 427 version is an increase of 8,061 for the solid waste employees and 11,565 for the recycling related to compensation-related employee changes, just like what we did in the general fund. They're getting, this includes actual employees that are in there that are getting the increases for the merit in the reclassification study. Mm-hmm. There's proposed changes on the bottom, 1% increase for hourly employees, 98. I did go back and look at that, and it was $98. It just seemed like it should have been higher. Mm-hmm. Let's see. Okay, where's that sheet at? It's in the back of my sheet. Page 45, there's an explanation of his changes. There's a reduction of $75,000, $75,500 to realignment between hauling and disposal accounts. Then there's an offsetting, an increase of $75,500 for realignment between hauling and disposing. So it's, they're just really realigning between accounts. And $31,800 for landfill tipping fee, contingency of 4%. $1.50 a ton. And also on the bottom of that page, underneath the tipping fee of $31,800, a reduction to also do PAYGO for OPEB in this fund. Okay? Any questions on the solid waste and recycling fund?
Nope. Move on.
All right. Page 47, Miscellaneous Revolving Fund. That's on page 66 in the recommended budget book. Changes that we made on April 27th, we actually reduced the revenue and expense for the Sheriff's Federal Forfeiture Fund and actually reduced, that was $180,000 in the recommended budget, and now we're proposing for this draft to be $100,000. And the same with the expense. And the Sheriff's Local Forfeiture Fund, in the recommended, it was $54,500, and we're proposing it to be $40,000. That is consistent with what the actual revenue that was in the fund equity in the collections. And if there needs to be more, if the revenues actually come in higher in those two areas, we do have, you can see it's an appropriation reserve in this fund of $184,000. They can come back with a budget amendment. But right now, based on the actual revenues that are in the fund balance, that fund equity at June 30, 2014, and also based on the current collections this year, that revenue should only be $100,000 for the Sheriff's Federal Forfeiture and $40,000 for the Sheriff's Local Forfeiture. And the expense was adjusted. And there's actually the same like everybody else. There's an increase of $1,914 increase for compensation-related expenses. The sheriff's, not the sheriff, state's attorney's drug enforcement fund has one position and it's unfilled, but we increase it just like the other positions, even though it's unfilled. And there's a proposed change. If you look on page 48, we're reducing the fuel operations expense. You can see that under the revenue, the first line. They actually had an upgraded the fuel facilities, and that actually happened, I think, in 2014. You can see the under that 2014 actual an increase of $60,769. That was actually budgeted again in 2015. I think there was still some additional items, but it is now complete, and they don't need that extra $60,000. So that's going to be a reduction. Any questions on the Miscellaneous Revolving Fund? Oh, we have one more. Page 49, we have the Emergency Services Support Fund. Mm-hmm. That is on page 68 in the recommended budget book. We actually have a correction on the AMIS that was to the recommended. If you look at the version 427, it should have been $234,000. So that correction has been made.
Oh, yeah.
And so you can. Page 49, the Emergency Services Support Fund. Right. And the recommended that revenue for the AMIS should have been $234,000. You see that?
Okay.
It should have been 234.
Got lost for a second.
All right. And then we have proposed changes. So the revenue difference, we're going to increase that by 34,000. And then the expenditures, there's an increase of 3,377 due to compensation related. There is one employee in this fund, the recruiter. And then proposed changes is below. Actually, in the state report, they're showing that now, instead of 234, it should be 268. So we're increasing that revenue again by another 34,000, and also increasing the fire and the rescue. We will do that in the next version. They're going to be getting an extra 17,000 each for the allocation. Okay, going forward. Mm-hmm. We've gone through the general fund. We're pretty good, 10 after 3. General fund, we've gone through the enterprise funds. Do you have any changes or anything else you'd like to talk about before I go to the fund balance?
I want to make an observation about these enterprise funds.
Okay.
And this is to my fellow commissioners. Look at this revenue balances. And what I'm really going to here is what we're charging people to use, whether it's the gymnastics center or our solid waste or our recs and parks. Okay. Wacomico, negative $36,685. Small number. Miscellaneous resolving fund. They got a budget surplus of $452,000. Solid waste, $1,661,000. Recs and parks, $366,000. Emergency services, $1,648,000. We're talking about $4 million. And that's over and above, and Commissioner Morgan is correct. We have probably accumulated these over time. But I think it's time for us to start charging people less, whether it be the people in the gymnastics center. We're definitely talking about doing something different on trash. But we're collecting more money than we need. And it just seems like we ought to get to a point. I'm sorry, did I catch somebody by surprise? Oh, okay. My point is that I was at that gymnastics thing the other night with a couple commissioners, and the point was is those people were talking about paying $10 late fees. And one woman talked about she paid 6 times. Another woman said she paid 3 times. The woman that paid it 6 times said she's a single mom with 2 kids. Good news is she has a decent job. But still, we're collecting money we don't need. I'm not sure, Jeanette, how we revisit a way to get these fund balances down, definitely below the $1 million, which we're doing in solid waste, but emergency services and on the recs and parks and the miscellaneous, getting them down to by a couple $100,000. It seems like we can make some adjustments on what we're charging people to use our enterprise funds and make it a little less expensive.
So we would need to look at our fees that are in each one of these.
Yes.
And then come back to you with maybe a proposed change.
Well, I mean, that's my idea, but it's up to you.
So I build on it. I would separate the trash out because the trash money that accumulated $1.6 million is because we moved that funding internally because we expected it. It wasn't a fee to the people who use the trash whatsoever. In fact, they haven't paid, as Commissioner Connors put out, what it costs for the trash removal for a long, long time, and that's why we have it. But great observation. We're going to do the course correction by putting that $1 million towards next year, and we may not use it all. So that would be some of that $1 million will be added to the $600,000 living there. And so what I'd recommend, and I'm sure Commissioner Hewitt would agree with me, is next year we'll look at it again, because as we go forward in trying to get to the actual cost of user's fee for trash, if we have fund balance that we don't need, we should be allocating that back. And so we may next year have another opportunity to do a little bit of it, but maybe not the whole thing.
We should be looking at that kind of stuff probably on an annual basis. I think we started on that back in October, November. We called it like a universal fee process. We did send out information to all the departments requesting their fees, why they collect them, how they collect them, and it's sitting upstairs. We really need to find time to review it, and maybe that's something we can review in time for the next budget season and bring back to you with some proposals or changes.
Because I've also received some input from folks using the Garvey Center that are other groups and folks that use libraries that get charged a certain fee to use the facilities. And so I think it's definitely we should.
It's time to look at it, yes.
And that's where I'm kind of coming from. There's a group that approached me, the sewing group. I mean, I guess, you know, people like to do stuff. I don't do much sewing, but people like to sew. And they go to the Garvey Center, and now they're being told they may have to pay a fee to go over there and sew. I mean, come on. Seems like we ought to be able to figure a way around that.
So let us take the information that we have, collect more if we need it, and then come back, and this will be part of the 2017 budget, reviewing the fees.
Okay.
One of them, October, November time frame.
Yeah, like we'll start back up in September with the calendar.
Sure.
You know,
sure.
It's like the year-round thing.
I think we need to look at it very cautiously,
yes.
Because we are not charging as much as the other counties already. The emergency services support fund cannot even be put into that equation at all. It was set up so we could do loans, buy equipment, apparatuses, so that, you know, millions of dollars that are sitting there is automatically removed from the equation. There's a huge benefit that the citizens get from that the tax is collected, and this is a way for, you know, our companies and EMS to purchase equipment. And then the fees that Commissioner Hewitt's talking about, I think that really, when it comes down to the customer service and looking at customer service, because if they're paying late fees because they couldn't get there at a particular time, and that's all that fee was a $10 late fee, and she had to leave in lunch and couldn't get there in time, so it was late. Maybe we do look at our late fees and look at the customer service, and so they're not paying the late fees.
Right.
However, the one thing I do realize when looking at all of these enterprise funds is that one is paying for the other. So it's one lump sum of money that is getting moved, in essence, one lump sum, that's getting moved between, you know, whether it's gymnastics or football or basketball, because if one doesn't break even, the other does. So when we're looking at fees, very cautiously, because the last thing we want to do is go ahead and proceed forward and have one of our programs suffer because we lowered fees and the other can't balance the other out.
You can kind of see that go up and down over the years.
Yes, exactly.
One program will do better than the other.
And I'd hate to cut the fees that are there, which are already low compared to the rest of the counties and various others, if you look at them, where they're paying for parks and rec fees. And all of a sudden, we're back here in a year and a half, 2 years, and we have to raise fees. So we're going to lower them, then we're going to have to raise them. You know, I think this should be a constant that we're looking at moving forward. Okay. So cautiously, I say.
And I would add to this that, especially with late payments because people can't get to where they need to drop a paycheck off, well, that to me just reeks that we need to upgrade our technology. There's no reason why people shouldn't be able to use a credit card and go online to pay their fees. And I know that our Treasurer's Department just shifted recently over to be more online friendly. And I think going forward, that's something we need to also take a look at.
Well, actually, to that point, I had forwarded an email from one of the constituents speaking to the webpage and updates for parks and recs, payments, and everything along those lines to Dr. Bridget. So she's already working with Mr. Kelly to add those features to the county webpage so people can just go online and do that. And whatever's working behind the scenes, I don't know, but I know there's forward momentum.
That's great. And the last piece of that I'd add in is a lot of it has to do with communications. Yeah. So you have a lot of users out who come in to use a facility, and maybe sometimes they pay a small fee to use it, and other times they don't pay a small fee. And then the question always comes up, well, why didn't I pay that time and I don't have to pay this time? So just a very clear and open communications plan, which certainly something our website can handle, of this is what it costs to borrow, to rent a room in the library, et cetera. So they're consistent, constant, and easy, in an ease of payment. I think it would make a huge difference in our consumer confidence in county funds and county equipment and resources.
You guys have put an awful lot of stuff on the website. It might blow up on us.
Randy, you'll be all right.
Override it. Just so you don't raise my $3 fee on Monday and Thursday for my exercise at the Garvey Center, okay?
As long as it's consistent, Randy.
Randy, if you...
the person gets what he needs, right? I'll jump in. It's called PayPal. Everybody else uses PayPal. I don't know why we can't use PayPal along the way. And I'm on the Emergency Services Support Fund. The concern I have in the long run is the LOSAP.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a huge actuarial value there that we're not coming close to. And again, it is an enterprise fund. And Candidly, LOSAP is our volunteers. We don't have fire, we don't have rescue, we don't have volunteers, and that's paid services, and that is one hell of a lot more money than it is for catching up to our LOSAP accrual. So all kinds of things considered, LOSAP is going to be one of the big gorillas sitting in this whole
we got to keep that going.
Fund balance thing that we have to worry about on the emergency services side and the enterprise fund side.
Right. I mean, I'm sure there's fees that we don't need to recoup, such as selling. Like, I'm sure you. I mean, you know, I agree, and I guess the litmus.
Don't raise my exercise fee either.
Yeah. But for the web page, I think the litmus test will be if Randy can use it.
Exactly. If I could use it, we'll have it.
Everybody's good. That's it.
Okay. Anything else on that?
All right. The last item. Fund balance. In the recommended budget, we were using we can go to page 8. The amount was $5,111,175. Currently, in this draft, we're using $5,498,675, and the change is, again, the $387,500 for the textbooks and the library collection at Duke Elementary. So on the bottom of that page, and of course you can see the list of the items that we're using it for, non-recurring items, that's what we use fund balance for. Proposed, we've already had discussion, paying off the lease for the Board of Education, $1.6 million. $92,000 for additional non-recurring county departments. Now, that was in HR and Land Use and Growth Management. Now, I will change that by the $14,000. That was in the HR because now we're going to put $57,000 in that budget for something to look at, maybe a possibility of a FTE. Mm-hmm. We have money still left over to get to. You can see the total unassigned June 30, 2014. For the plan, maybe using another $4.6 million in PAYGO or other non-recurring in this budget, and then leaving $11 million, which is half of the $22 million, for anything to, you know, change in the revenue estimates, just to give us a cushion, and also in case we have, like, a big hurricane or something, so that we can react to make sure that if something does happen, we're protected. And you heard Sam Ketterman last week. You know, it's good to keep a certain amount of fund balance. We do have a lot of fund balance in there. We're doing the 6% for the bond rating. We have the $1.6 million in there for the rainy day. But this would also provide more stability for the county. And the bond ratings do like, agencies do like to see that we do increase and keep a certain amount available in case something happens that we can react to.
I've been on record as saying we have a lot of fund balances.
Yes.
And looking at these $4 million or so in this enterprise fund, you know, that's another eye-opener for me in this getting to know you process. I guess what I have to say is I do believe in fund balances, but I also believe in the right sizing,
right,
the amount of money that we have, and that if we can't give it back in tax, lower taxes, that we give it back and something to look at, whether it be a library, a Garvey Center, whatever it be. So thanks. This has been a good first year for me, and maybe next year I'll be better.
You will be back next year.
Yeah. You got three years. 7 months and 4 days.
Like, at least that far to go, yeah.
Now, we also made a very optimistic step going forward to realize a 4%. And so I think we need to keep a fairly healthy
income tax, and that's another reason why, right, the growth. I want to make sure that in case that doesn't come forward, or, you know, I do know, I think we did hit the revenue estimate for property taxes. I think I double-checked with that, and it looked like we were close to where we should be on that. And also, I did check, I'm not sure if I said this first, I did check the website on the property taxes to see if that revenue could be increased. It looked like it could have gone up maybe slightly, But then when I looked at the next year for 2017, it was going back down again. So that's why I'm not touching the revenue estimate. But I'll bring back something on that constant yield.
Okay.
Good. Good.
For the, as far as the schools are concerned, you know, I want to see where we can try and find the money to go ahead and help Mr. Smith negotiate. And the reason I say negotiate is because me personally, I don't, nor will I be held hostage by a union. But I want to be able to give him the tools to do the job. And in saying that, my position is that they bargaining and you know negotiations are a back and forth process. So whether it's rumors or you know the emails I'm getting from people in the PTA, et cetera, are off base. You know, the fact that I'm not going to budge until I get all of the funding doesn't work for me. You know, it's back and forth. This is how this works. So you give, you get. So that's where I sit with that. So if there's some sort of middle ground that's found, then I'm happy to work with that. But I want to make sure he has the tools to do the job and help in the negotiations, not demands. So that's where I sit.
And I'll jump on where Commissioner Jarbo was. We were optimistic on our revenue expectations. We did manipulate a little bit the OPEB to create a little bit more revenue. But I remember a year and a half ago when we had a couple of $20 million of fund balance to take care of Duke and Spring Ridge Elementary. And as easy and as much as we can quibble about fund balance, the fact that the boards in the past have saved enough money to put $20 million forth to get Duke moving and to get Spring Ridge moving is one of the reasons I advocate, you know, having that strong fund balance, much as the Davenport Group said, because, you know, as you point out, hurricanes can happen and other storms can happen, but, you know, one big calamity to the schools can happen, and then that balance goes, as I said, it was a blink of an eye to give $20 million out last year, as you know and many people in the room know.
I agree.
Anything else, guys?
The only thing I'm going to say is unions aren't bad. Unions are good. You know, what happens is you get cost certainty. You know what something's going to cost you. Now, negotiations are the key, and Commissioner Carney, you're right. You need to give your negotiators the latitude to make a good deal. But the key, again, is we're in this together. It's not us and them. It's all us. So the point is why people negotiate a deal, they know what they're going to get, we know what we're going to pay, but we also know what we're going to get in services. So I'll say, hey, they're not going away.
And you're in Maryland, and you're right, they're not going away.
Right. And I wasn't trying to infer that unions were bad. I myself was a part of a collective bargaining unit, FOP 89. However, It was all about bargaining and negotiations, and you know, and that's it. It was always negotiating. We never made demands and stood our ground. So hopefully they're just vicious rumors.
There you go.
That's it. That's what I hope for.
So are you okay with this plan? Do another $4.6 million in PECO? Or
yes, but we don't actually spend it until you show us what you're spending.
That's right. Next week, we're discussing CIP.
There you go. There you go.
So I will bring back, I'll take that, and we will rebalance the CIP. We're going to look at it. I'll update the changes spreadsheet. We'll bring that back, and all the sheets that we showed you today will have updated versions, and we'll come back for, now we can go back to the agenda in case I've missed something. I think you already gave me some other considerations and direction. Was there anything else that you would like to talk about? We can go and look at the next steps on the agenda. Final direction and changes to the approved budget is next week. We have one more work session. So we're going to finish up operating. We're going to finish up the capital. And we're going to talk about the Navy Museum. And then on the 12th, you're going to approve this budget in your first budget. So that's kind of exciting, and set tax rates and make a decision on the library, is what you had said earlier.
Right.
And then we'll bring back on May 26th and approve the final budget for the Board of Education and the METCOM CIB.
Yes.
Sounds good. Any other questions, commissioners? Jeanette, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Very good job.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other discussions? This budget workshop is now closed.